I'm in heaven, and my heart beats so that I can hardly speak. And I seem to find the happiness I seek when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek.
Probably most people can't afford to buy the originals. I mean, I bought my first Jack Vetriano for £1,500, probably now. Well, it's an early one, so I don't know what it fetches now.
Seem to vanish like a gambler's lucky streak when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek.
Vetriano has had the gall to say that I don't like his pictures because they're about sex, which is actually nonsense. I mean, I don't like his pictures because they're supposed to be about sex, but aren't.
Yeah, obviously, he is not a great artist in the way that, say, Francis Bacon is a great artist, but I don't think he's ever pretended to be. But he is remarkably good at depicting an atmosphere.
I was at the Edinburgh Festival about 3 or 4 years ago, and I got to know a chap that owned a bar, as you do, and he was talking about Vetriano, and he said, "Oh, we've got this chap, a Scots chap, he's Italian Scots chap, working out," and he says, he loves doing girls and sausages. And I go, what do you mean? Yeah, he loves doing these pictures of girls and their sausages. So what do you mean, sausages? Well, it's suspenders, okay, fine. Yeah, okay.
And I seem to find the happiness I seek when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek.
In the space of 10 years, self-taught painter Jack Vetriano has gone from obscurity to being one of Britain's most popular painters. A mining engineer till his early 20s, posters of the artist's work now outsell the celebrated masters like Monet. But in Jack Vetriano's world, nothing is simple. His paintings are not hung in public galleries, and the critics at best say his work is poster art. At worst, they say it's pornographic.
I think there's a kind of insecurity about me that, you know, because I got here on my own, that perhaps I'm scared a company of artists might expose me in some way. I've known a couple of painters. I mean, not serious friendships, but, I've enjoyed their company. But I think I've only enjoyed their company because we rarely talked about art. I really don't have that much to say about it. I'm also conscious of advice that I got some years ago, and that was that, you know, just plough your own furrow. I mean, just do your own thing. You're not handicapped by the fact that you didn't go through the system. You're actually quite lucky. You're not shackled by anybody else's preachings and teachings. I think I quite like my own company.
There's definitely a light and a dark side to Jack, I feel. The beach scenes I love. They're very magical, very romantic, and wonderful wide beaches, and the wind is blowing, and the dresses are caught up with the girls. They're always wearing these lovely sort of spotted dresses. He's almost painting of another time. The clothes he uses are out of another period. People don't really dress like that now. And I think Jack harks back to a time when he was growing up and the girls were always very dressed. And if you notice, even when Jack paints a nude, she's wearing very, very high-heeled shoes, because I think Jack likes those kind of women. He obviously paints the kind of women he likes. The men, again, if they're on the beach, they might have taken their jacket off, but they've always got a tie on. They're always very smartly dressed in whatever situation they're in. So in that sense, you're looking almost at another period.
The beach paintings came about quite curiously. I used to travel by train to Edinburgh, and Burnt Island's got this fabulously sort of flat beach, and you'd see those men out in the mornings digging for bait, and the reflection of their bodies in pools of water. You know, I thought, that's a lovely effect, that. And so I did a painting, and it was at this exhibition at Dunkeld, and this old lady came up to me and she said, you know, you're really good at beaches, son. And I was very conscious of thinking, you know, this human comedy isn't only played out in dance halls and in bars, because when I think back in the 60s, I mean, Leven was a very popular holiday resort, and the game of courtship went on whether the sun was shining or not. You know, the promenade was full of you know, young people out there, you know, eyeing up the Talon. So, you know, I thought, yeah, there's no need for everything to be indoors at all. You know, the ritual goes on wherever you are. It was the 60s when I started to go dancing, and there was no such thing as a discotheque, and all you had were these sort of old-fashioned ballrooms, which were gorgeous places. There used to be a band, it was the Andy Ross Orchestra, and they used to do this lovely thing where they would play three fast records and three slow, and at the end of the three fast, they would do this little sort of a musical piece, which was da-da-da-da-da. But what that meant was it was sort of cue, three slow records coming up, you know, on your marks, get set. And that was when my friend and I used to dash from the balcony down, you know, for the three slow records. And of course that became a painting.
Sell-out exhibitions in Hong Kong and South Africa, Vetriana's paintings are bought and sold around the world. An estimated 400 people are on the waiting list to purchase an original painting. But Vetriano is better known for his poster reproductions. To date, 500,000 posters have been sold worldwide.
Well, I don't regard Jack Vetriano's work as painting. I do regard it as poster art. In fact, I have never ever written anything about Jack Vetriano in my column in the Herald, and I've never spoken about Jack Vetriano before for the simple reason that I didn't find his work interesting. But I think it is a phenomenon, and when you say an irresistible rise, I've found his rise entirely irresistible.
Despite the disdain of the arts establishment, Vetriana's work has found its way into the most sophisticated surroundings. Sir Terence Conran commissioned six paintings for his exclusive London Bluebird Club, themed on the record attempts of Sir Malcolm Campbell.
We based this club around the archive of, you know, the great racing driver. And Jack got extremely excited about this. He thought it was just exactly his sort of thing. And Jack produced a series of wonderful pictures for us. I know there's been criticism by various art critics in Scotland of Jack's work, but I would certainly say, why shouldn't there be excellent popular art? You know, I see nothing wrong with excellent work being in shopping malls.
Vetriano's most famous print, The Singing Butler, has sold 220,000 copies. He receives a royalty payment on each print sold and is reputed to earn £200,000 per year on poster sales alone.
The Singing Butler, if we must talk about him, you know, it's just one of those odd things that I just had this idea to do an eccentric couple in this butler, and then the maid came in, and I thought, well, you know, what are they dancing to? And it just came to me, you know, he's singing to them, you know, and a legend was born.
The very public face of Jack Vetriano's work can be seen in poster shops throughout the country. But beneath the apparent romance of his beach scenes lies an altogether different obsession.
I think when I moved to Edinburgh, the sort of themes of the work were a kind of nostalgic sort of look back at my youth in these ballrooms and on beaches and, you know, behind the co-op and kiss and cuddle sort of stuff. But I think I started to think pretty deeply about how we get by as man and woman, you know, and what does love really mean, and the whole sort of question of sex and how powerful that is in certain people, you know, and how it drives them and often drives them to destruction. And so I think the paintings got darker in that sense. And I think from then on, I mean, I've done less and less of the kind of rosy-coloured, beachy paintings. But you know, Gordon Smith used to say to me that it was probably a fair proportion, you know, like 10% of my thoughts are romantic, you know, and 90 are dark, and that's the rough proportion you get. You know, these beach paintings were a kind of reflection of the part of me that's hopeful, and the dark paintings are the part of me that's absolutely, you know, and a total cynic.
Professor Duncan Macmillan's recently revised history of Scottish art, Jack Vetriano is given a less than flattering appraisal. Macmillan's critique of Vetriano is the culmination of a five-year war of words between the critic and the artist that has seen Macmillan go as far as describing the work as pornographic.
Jack Vetriano's painting all seems to be about sex. But I think if you look at it closely, that is actually, in a way, it's an illusion, because the fact that his figures are so inexpressive, you know, they're actually, you know, they're really, this is a matter of the limitations of his technique, that he can't invest a face or a body with any really meaningful expression. This immediately gives a kind of detachment to these figures. At first sight, you think this, you know, this is the image of modern alienation and the loneliness of sex, but it doesn't stand up. They're not saying anything to each other, because they actually are incapable of any kind of expression. They're just sort of blank, sitting, you know, painted together in one space. That's really the nub of my criticism. I mean, it's supposed to be about sex. It's not. Indeed, Vetriano has had, had the gall to say that I don't like his pictures because they're about sex, which is absolute nonsense. I mean, I don't like these pictures because they're supposed to be about sex, but aren't. You know, they're about, well, they don't actually come to being about anything very much.
People might be surprised when I say that I've got the utmost respect for Duncan Macmillan. He is an expert in the history of Scottish art, but we should never imagine that that means he's got good taste. And art is just about taste. You know, you either like it or you don't like it. He and I clearly don't share the same thing about, you know, what sexiness is. I mean, I remember reading somewhere that he said that, you know, the tension of a muscle, you know, could be sexy. Well, excuse me, but, you know, I need just a wee bit more to get me wound up. You know, but that's his opinion. I mean, he's also, much, I think, to the horror of the Central Belt of Scotland, said my work was pornographic, because they came in their droves to Kirkcaldy to see the porn. And I think they all went away feeling they had been shortchanged. You know, when I started to kind of think about life and love and marriage and all of that sort of thing, and, you know, the whole ritual of courtship, I sort of concluded that when you're young, you know, it's all sort of rough and tumble and, you know, groping and falling about over sofas and stuff. But I think some of us, I'm not saying I'm one of them, but I know some people to whom ritual is all important, you know, that you're in the right setting, your most favourite piece of music's on, you've eaten your favourite food, you've got your favourite champagne, and, you know, she's in her favourite dress, and, you know, everything is coming together, you know, and you're having just a hell of a night. You know, it's that sort of, that's what I mean about ritual, where you work hard at getting it right. You know, nobody pops round in trainers and a T-shirt and says, hey, let's chill out. You know, they come at the time they're supposed to come, and people are dressed for the occasion, you know, and I just think it just heightens the sensation, you know, and I think if I found out anything about myself, it's that I am a sensation seeker.
Venus as
I think from probably 10, 11, 12 years old, I've always had this, I wouldn't call it an obsession, but I like a certain sort of sexual overtness in women. You know, I wouldn't go as far as to call it a cheapness, but a certain overtness. And of course then it was, you know, women were going around in their beehive hairstyles and, you know, everyone was wearing nylons and high heels. And I think that, I think for some of us, that image you take to your grave, you know, nothing else quite does it. And I think too, I mean, it's just such a, it's such a kind of obvious femininity to me, you know, that kind of underwear.
I know there's been a lot of accusations of Jack being very sexist and putting women down. I don't think he does. I think Jack likes women. I think he likes them dressed up and rather glamorous. And I think the women in his pictures are very... They know what they're doing, you know. They're not going to be taken along for a ride if they don't want to be. They're willing participants, I think, in whatever it's happened. They're always dressed up, looking like they're hoping something might happen.
His work, rather than being forward-looking, is incredibly nostalgic, and nostalgic in perhaps not that savoury a way. I know lots of people like it very much, but looking at it, it reminds me of nothing so much as Dennis Potter and the preoccupations that he had with the darkness that lay underneath the kind of calm surface of 30s and 40s society.
Petriano constantly includes himself in his paintings, or indeed there's a whole series of self-portraits. I find them quite disturbing because he dramatizes himself. You know, he's always looking kind of sultry and dark and trying to look moody. Then he puts himself as this kind of bad-tempered, narcissistic, potentially violent person into his pictures, along with some kind of woman. The relationship is dodgy, I think. You know, it suggests that what's going on in his mind, and after all he's painting himself, so we are being invited to consider this is going on in his mind, perhaps doesn't bear too close examination. Sex may be the theme, but it's not a particularly attractive kind of sex that is being suggested.
I mean, we could call it sex, but it's not just sex. It never is just sex. It's you know, it's more than that. You know, they need the other body. They need the affection. And as soon as something good is laid on their table, you know, they don't want it. They only ever really want what they can't get, and that's what drives them night after night to go out there and seek it.
There obviously is an obsessive quality to his themes that reoccur, but there's nothing wrong with that either. I mean, if you're not painting from obsession or need, then you're not really the creative artist, you're an interpretive artist. That's why a lot of erotic art is continually driven by the obsessional needs and becomes rather wonderful, because you know this person is drawn to painting, is almost driven to painting or drawing these images. And that erotic nature of them being driven is invested in the work.
When I look at particularly the interior shots, those evening coal fire lit shots, I keep saying shots, it's so photographic and stuff. And the enclosed pictures of domestic scenes of men and women together, I really do find them to be not celebratory but quite threatening. I really get a whiff off of them of bad old days when behind closed doors awful things went on between men and women that were never spoken of, rape within marriage not existing, the idea that really, you know, men had the right to take a swing at their women if they were acting up. I really feel that in Vietriano's work there is a real acceptance that this is all part of the game between men and women and this kind of stuff is acceptable.
People have private lives. The paintings aren't actually intruding very far into those private lives because you never see what they're about to do. You see that they are about to do something, and then you add whatever's next, which is why it's so interesting when people find them so offensive, because they're obviously adding something really fairly appalling, but it's not necessarily there. It's like, well, yeah, maybe they're going to have a great time. If you look at the work of the Impressionists, I mean, Nudie Lady Under a Tree Surrounded by Dressed Men, I'd have much more of a problem with, because the nudie lady tends to be very passive. Or even if she's a nudie lady by herself, you know, with just that little kind of titillating something around the neck that implies that slight edge of bondage. And I'd much more of a problem with your Monets and your Manets than this guy.
Jack Vetriano is a great craftsman. The draftsmanship's fine, the vanishing points are fine, the colour's fine, the textures are good, the lighting's good in the picture. There's a hint of mystery. There's nothing salacious, and yet he does like, you know, to get the gear off the girls. It's got the feel of New York jazz to it. I mean, you could hear a clarinet playing in the background while you look at his picture. It gives you that little moment. It's almost like a window on the past, even if it's only imaginary past. And that memory and that kind of New York nightscape that is firmly imprinted on our imaginations, even if we've never been to the city. And when you finally get to the city, you go, oh, yes, it's just like the movies. And what you want to hear is, blah, 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 blah. Oh, yes, so we're there. I go, hello. It's rock and roll. It's jazz. It's good. It's a special feeling.
In November 1999, Vetriano held his first exhibition in America at the 20th Century Arts Fair in New York. In anticipation of owning one of the 20 paintings on show, an estimated 50 fans traveled from Britain.
Who's number six? I can't read the name.
One hopeful queued outside for 12 hours to buy the painting of his dreams.
My name's John Clemo. I've come over from England. I've got a particular painting that I'd like to buy, which is Beautiful Losers. And with number one ticket, I'm hoping that I'll get it. But having said that, I do want to have a look at it first. Yeah, I think I like it, but I'm not a dealer or anything, and it needs to be the one that I want.
If I could explain what we'd like to do, we were going to issue the tickets in the order in which people arrived. We're not going to sell any paintings till 6:15 to give everybody a chance to have a look. And then we'll do it strictly by rotation. Number one has first choice for one painting, number two has second choice, and so on. Have a drink, have a look, take your time, and then we'll go from there.
I'm not sure I have a favourite, but each one has a wee bit of me in it.
See, look at this, series of horizontals and verticals.
It's nice.
It's very nice.
It's much better personally.
If you want that one.
1 hour after the exhibition opens, all 20 paintings have been sold for a total of $387,000.
John,
hi.
I believe you've got number one.
I have, absolutely.
Would you like to get it to me and tell me which painting you'd like?
Beautiful Losers.
Delighted.
Please.
Thrilled.
Thank you very much.
Very good. Thanks very much.
Well done.
Yeah, good.
Like
Thank you very much. Brilliant. Yeah. It's absolutely brilliant.
Good.
Lovely. Would you sign the book?
Yeah.
John and Lindsay, L.Y.
Pleased with his purchase, John happily pays the asking price of $35,000.
I got the one I wanted. I looked at it, and it is as good as I hoped it would be, and it's wonderful. And it has got the Leonard Cohen connection, which was important to me as well. Very pleased indeed. Yeah, it's exactly what I'd hoped for, and a year and a half to get it, but it was well worth it. Wonderful picture.
Yes, I was here to buy the Scarlet Ribbons, lovely ribbons, and I got it. So I'm really excited, really pleased. I bought it for my husband, actually, for his birthday next year, so I've got to keep it secret for 10 months.
I was the best man at the wedding, so... and he doesn't know she's here, so it's all a bit of a secret. A bit Petriano type, really, I suppose.
People are voting with their feet across there, and I can ask for no more than that. I mean, there's nothing I can do about the fact that critics in Scotland don't like the work, nothing I can do about it.
I understand that 400 or so people will be waiting in line to buy the next Jack Vetriano original, and that Vetriano posters are selling like Walker's crisps. I really find that it's art's equivalent of a never-ending desire to find out what's going on next with Posh Spice. There's a simplicity of technique and a simplicity of narrative here that appeals simply because it's not demanding and it is voyeuristic. And it really doesn't mean much or say much.
I think a lot. I mean, I think it's all me. Because I wouldn't paint anything that didn't touch me. You know, I wouldn't paint anything, you know, to make some money, you know, to make a cheap buck. Sometimes I've hung an exhibition and, you know, before the public are near it and looked at it and thought that, you know, I am giving a lot away, but I think, well, you know, it's kind of your destiny. I mean, Christ, you know, I wouldn't have it any other way. I never said I was an important artist in Scotland or anywhere for that matter. I've never said I was on any cutting edge or pushing any boundaries at all. You know, that's not what I'm about. I sometimes think that I'm more like a film producer, but I just want to do stills. That's all I want to do, and I just want to do them well.
I think that's the world he likes to create for himself. I think he'd quite like to step into these pictures, truthfully, and live in this world alone, wouldn't you think so? I'll go with him. We'll go with him for the weekend anyway.